অবত সহন ভুনক্ত সহ বীর্যঙ্করবাবহৈ তেজস্বিনাবধীতমস্তু মা বিদ্বেষাবহৈ। ওম শান্তি শান্তি শান্তি। ওম পূর্ণমদ পূর্ণমিদম পূর্ণাত পূর্ণমুদচ্যতে পূর্ণস্য পূর্ণমাদায় পূর্ণমেবাবশিষ্যতে। ওম শান্তি শান্তি শান্তিঃ। শ্রুতিস্মৃতিপুরাণানাম আলয়ং করুণালয়ম নমামি ভগবৎপাদম শঙ্করম লোকশঙ্করম শঙ্করম শঙ্করাচার্যম কেশবম বাদরায়ণম সূত্রভাষ্যকৃতৌ বন্দে ভগবন্তৌ পুনঃ পুনঃ ঈশ্বরো গুরুরাত্মেতি ভেদবিভাগিনে ব্যোমবদ্ব্যাপ্তদেহায় দক্ষিণামূর্তয়ে নমঃ। শ্রীহরিম পরমানন্দম উপদেষ্টারমীশ্বরম ব্যাপকম সর্বলোকানাম কারণম তম নমাম্যহম। অপরোক্ষানুভূতির্বৈ প্রোচ্যতে মোক্ষসিদ্ধয়ে। সদ্ভিরেব প্রয়ত্নেন বীক্ষণীয়া মুহুর্মুহুঃ। So we can see how the thought process, the vichara. It was said that vichara jnana siddhyartham atmana svamichchada vichara kartavya. The author said that the one who seeks the knowledge should carry out vichara or inquiry. Because no utpadde, without vichara or inquiry, knowledge does not arise. Because for gaining any kind of knowledge, you always require to inquire, investigate. And therefore, the nature of vichara is started. So this is how Vedantin proceeds with the thing. Koham, who am I? Kathamidam jatam, how is this universe born? Koive karta, who is the agent of creation? Upadanam kimasti, what is the material cause from which the universe has emerged? So not just who am I, all these questions. Because I is a part of the whole scheme, which includes the universe. Therefore, to understand I, we have to understand everything that is connected with I, to fully understand. Therefore, I cannot be understood in isolation of the universe. Therefore, what is the nature of universe? Meaning, where is it born? Who is the agent of creation? What is the material cause? So in this manner, then answer was found that I am not this body, I am not this mind, I am not the sense organs. I am someone who is totally distinct from all of this. In which I am the one who possesses characteristics that are quite distinct, quite contrary to this body, mind, sense complex. Therefore, I am someone different from them. What about the universe? Well, the universe is Katham jatam, how is it born? It is born because of ignorance and from ignorance. So ignorance is the cause of the universe. Sankalpo vividah karta. From that ignorance, what is born is sankalpa. May have this, may have that. So that sankalpa, the desire, is what in fact is the reason why the universe is what it is. See, there are two things. Number one, that the material cause for the pot is clay. At the same time, the reason why the pot is what it is, or what shape it is, what is decided by the sankalpa. It is the pot maker that decides what it is that I want. There were two things go into making this pot. The material, namely clay, as well as the desire to have a particular kind of pot. So material that goes into making universe is ignorance, and the desire, may it be like this, may it be like this, is what determines the actual configuration of the universe. Alright, what's the most fundamental essence? You say that ignorance is the material cause, the cause. The desire is the reason why we have the configuration which decides the specifics. Meaning, ignorance is the universal aspect of everything, and the desire or sankalpa is the particular aspect. What's the cause of all of this? Ekam sukshmam sadavyam. The ultimate cause, the ultimate substrate of all of this is one subtle existence which is imperishable. So this is how vichara has been initiated. In that process, first was carried out because in saying, who am I? What was said is that, naham bhuta gano dehaha, I am not this body, which is the product of the five elements. Nor am I the sense organs, nor am I the mind, which are also produced from the five elements. So then, you separate the I from the non-I. Because of ignorance, both of them are lumped together. And therefore, first step is the need to assert, I am not this body, I am distinct from that. So then there is a whole section where it was asserted, I am not this body. So, looks at life and sees what is happening. How Atma is so distinctly different from body or anatma, that there is no logical possibility of one confusing one for the other. I mean, pot is such an object, totally, I can never confuse pot to myself, I can never say I am pot. And worse than that, the characteristics of body are so contrary to characteristics of Atma that really it just does not logically make sense that someone may take this body to be Atma. By the way, we have this seat here, that backjack. If someone wants to use that, you can use it. That's why it isn't brought. Okay. So, okay, if you need it, then take it. Oh, there is one more. Camp it is. Achha, in case anybody needs. So author expresses surprise. Look at the glory, I shouldn't say glory, but look at the impact of ignorance. That what is impossible has become possible in our life, that Atma, who is totally distinct from the body, mind, sense complex, having characteristics that are totally contradictory, contrasting the anatma or non-self, where it just doesn't make sense that one can take this body to be the self. And still that's what we find. We find the impossible thing in our life. That what is anatma like a part? I never take it to be myself. The body also falls in that category as an object. And I take it to be myself. If the body deserved to be called the self, if the body, mind, sense complex had the characteristics, where there was some similarity, then you can confuse one thing for the other. You can confuse the rope for the... Some similarity should be... There is no similarity. The body is made up of so many ingredients, so many limbs, and atma is free from... is formless. Is devoid of... Is niravayava. It's devoid of all the avayava, the limbs. The body is external, is an object, atma is subject. The body is impure, made of, you know, based on impure things. Atma is ever pure. The body is inert, atma is illuminated. The body is mithya, unreal, atma is real. So with all these kind of totally contradictory characteristics, how can it be that I take this body to be Atma? Indeed, that is the work of ignorance. So this is how ignorance manifests in our life. So ajnana prabhava, everything is a product of ignorance, is shown here how ignorance simply prevails in our life. Because we entertain about ourselves the notions or conclusions which have no logical basis at all. So ignorance creates such a delusion. You simply take something for what it is not. All right. So then what should we do? What's the need if I am not the body? Then what? Who am I? How should I know myself? Brahma evaham samashantah sachidananda lakshana. You say, I am not the body, I am not the mind. Who am I? Brahma evaham, I am Brahman. Samaha, equanimous, equally present everywhere. Shantah, ever tranquil. Sachidananda lakshana, of nature of sachit ananda. I am not this body, which is mithya. I am satya, I am real. Nirvik, I am changeless, I am formless, I am ever pure, I am imperishable. Not this body, which is impure, unreal. So this is how, first, I am not the body. Then who am I? Satchidan, niramayo, nirabhasah, nirgunah, nishkriyah, nityah, nirmalah, anantah. So this is how the knowledge of the self should take place, by distinguishing the self from the non-self. So therefore, now the teacher says, hey, come on, let me know yourself in this manner. Addressing some materialists who says, body is atma, body is a self, there is no self, or no consciousness, nothing other than body. This is what it is. So the body is not, self is not. Or even beyond that, somebody says, atma, there is no atma at all. What it is shunyam. So then he asks, how can you say this is shunyam? Look at this body. Swadehe shobhanam santam. The body may be whatever it is. It may be impure, it may be perishable, it may be changing, but still it serves an excellent, wonderful purpose. That it is a seat of manifestation of Atma, of consciousness, of limitless. So this extremely limited entity nevertheless is a seat of manifestation, limitless. And so don't you realize that Can you not go beyond the body and recognize that there is something, because with the body is alive, something that gives the body, you know, makes it sentient, something, so don't you see that fact? Shrutya yukta yuktya asks us, but Shrutya, look, the scripture tells you what the nature of Atma is. Yukti, and if you apply the reasoning properly, then also you can see what the nature of Atma is. So various Shrutis and Yuktis were told. So how the thought process is proceeding? What is Atma? Aham Shabdena Vikhyataha. That which everybody is familiar. Everybody is familiar with Atma. Atma is experienced by everybody at all the times. How? Aham Shabdena Vikhyataha. Aham. The very Aham or I. Atma is the content of I. It is one. The egos may be many, the ornaments may be many, but the content of ego is what? The witness, the consciousness is one. Just as gold is one, similarly there is only one I in all the living beings. Drashtu daya siddha. I am the drashta, the witness. The body is witnessed. I am one. The body is an aggregate of many. I am changeless. This body is always changing. So this is the yukti or the reasoning to establish that the body cannot be Atma, that I am distinct from the body and I am this one changeless principle. A number of quotations are given from the Upanishad. Because as we said, we are not proving what Atma is. We are not proving what God is by reasoning. Our knowledge of the nature of self or our knowledge of the nature of Ishvara is based on Shruti and the scripture. And then we provide supporting reason to realize that yes, that makes sense. We do not arrive at what Ishvara is or Atma is through reason. But the Shruti reveals the nature of self. Yasmat paramna paramasti kinjit yasman naniyo nijayosti kaschit. That is one above which there is nothing, below which there is nothing, other than which there is nothing. One that is changeless and sustaining and pervading everything. So this is how the Upanishad reveals the nature of self. That is our basis. It makes sense. There has to be one principle that sustains. There has to be a changeless principle that sustains all the changes. Change cannot be the ultimate reality. The change has to be sustained by the unchanging. The many cannot be the ultimate reality. Duality cannot be the ultimate reality. Division, you are different, I am different, you exclude me, that cannot be ultimate reality because my heart does not accept it. Swamiji, nobody loves duality. We never love the division. So when I am interacting with somebody, if I feel division, I think this person doesn't like me. I think person doesn't want me. Moment that division is, I feel uncomfortable. I feel comfortable only when there is harmony and oneness with whatever it is that I am interacting with. Is not so? Our heart loves oneness. Our heart is not comfortable, doesn't want separatedness, doesn't want division. So, if we in fact examine the urge in our heart, it is very clear that we only love non-duality. We love oneness. We do not love duality, we do not love division, we do not love to be excluded, like to be excluded, and I am not happy to exclude somebody also. I may exclude somebody out of anger or resentment, I don't know, but I am not happy with it. Therefore, exclusion we do not want. So we, if we really look at the urge in our heart, it becomes clear that the Advaita or non-duality is what we love, and that is what we are trying all the time. The effort in our life, we are striving constantly to create non-duality, as you know, because we find duality at a given level. And since we are not comfortable with duality, all along we are trying to create non-duality. Whether you can create or not, we are trying. By forming a family, and there's one idea. So man and woman get married and they have a family. You know, that's the idea of creating the non-duality. That I have a family unit where I feel one with them, and then I have a larger family. I have this group and that group and this club, whatever things we are doing. All of these are social, whatever it is, our attempts to, in some way, establish oneness. That's what we want. Of course, there are people who are perhaps unintelligent and who may have their minds are so pathetically distorted that they may take some satisfaction creating divisions. That may be so, but normally nobody wants that. So this is how, when we apply the reasoning, then we find that what the Upanishad reveals alone makes sense and nothing else. So this is how our Shraddha or the trust in the statements of the Upanishads become firm. That we don't simply swallow them or accept them without thinking. At the same time, we do not apply any kind of thinking. We always apply the supporting logic. So that way, Atma Anatma Viveka is carried out, that Atma is different from Anatma. When that is done, then a question arose. You're saying Atma is different from Anatma, body is different, my Atma itself is different from body, mind, sense complex. Are you then implying that Atma is one entity, Anatma is another entity? When you say Atma is different from Anatma, what kind of difference do you mean? When you say Atma, it's different from Anatma, that I am different from this body-mind complex. What kind of difference do you mean? The difference with which we are familiar is this, that when part is different from cloth, then cloth also is different from part. When part is, says I am not the cloth, cloth says I am not the part. So difference with which we are familiar is the difference of mutual exclusion. Therefore, when now Vedantin says Atma is different from Anatma, distinct from Anatma, untouched by Anatma, then the difference with which we are familiar is, our conclusion would be that Anatma also is different from Atma. Atma stands apart from Anatma, and Anatma stands apart from Atma. That would be our conclusion. Now that poses another problem. If the world stands apart from Atma, the body, mind, sense complex stands apart from Atma, then just as pot enjoys its own existence and cloth enjoys its own existence, then Atma enjoys its own existence, Anatma enjoys its own existence. That means then there are two independent realities, and then there is, we are coming back to Dvaitam or duality. So then the Vedantin has to explain, what is the nature of difference between Atma and Anatma? The difference is not the difference between pot and cloth, for the simple reason that the duality or difference that we are talking about, that part is different from cloth, and cloth is different from part. That would be so. Usually, if part is different from cloth, then cloth also will be different from part. That is true. When will it be true? When the part and cloth enjoy the same degree of reality. If the part and cloth enjoy the same degree of reality, then part is different from cloth, cloth is different from part. But when you talk of clay and pot, when clay says, I'm different from the pot, I'm not the pot, I'm different. Look at pot, it is a shape, form, I'm formless. Look at the pot, it's limited in this location, I'm not limited. This clay can claim, or proclaim rather, its distinction from the pot. That is true. But now can we say that the pot is different from clay? Meaning that Atma and Anatma do not enjoy the same degree of reality. If they did, then of course the separation would be real. As it turns out, Atma has a reality which is Paramadhika Satta, absolute reality. Anatma is a reality which we call the Vyavaharika Satta, the objective reality, relative reality. In Vedantic terms, we could say that Atma is Satyam, Anatma is Mithya. And the rope is Satyam, the snake is Mithya. Or clay is Satyam, pot is Mithya. Satyam is different from Mithya, but Mithya is not different from Satyam. That's a very unique equation in Vedanta. Usually what we are familiar with is, if one is different from the other, other also is different from this one. That's what we know, the difference we know. But no, here is a different kind of a difference. The clay is different from pot, but pot is not different from clay, because clay enjoys independent existence, pot only has a dependent existence. Clay is whether pot is there or not. Pot is because clay is. Pot is not when clay is not. This is called Anvaya Vyatireka. The method of agreement and disagreement. That pot is when the clay is Anvaya. Pot is not, clay is not, Vyatireka. So that simple reasoning establishes what is dependent and what is independent. Pot is when the clay is. Pot is not when the clay is not. Or clay is when the pot is. Clay is even when the pot is not. That means clay is independent of pot. And pot is dependent upon clay. What is independent is called Satyam. What is dependent is called Mithya. So in this example, clay is Satyam. Pot is Mithya. So Satyam is different from Mithya. But Mithya is not different from Satyam, because Mithya is not independent of Satyam. So that is what is to be understood now. That in spite of clay being different from pot, there is no duality between pot and clay. You follow? In spite of clay is different from pot, pot does not stand apart from clay, and therefore there is no division between the two. So Atma stands apart from everything. Asangoyam by asangaha, untouched, untainted by any limitations, by any shortcomings, by any defects of Anatma. At the same time, Anatma does not pose a duality. And therefore, that is what we call the non-duality, in spite of duality. Duality not in absence of non-duality, not absence of duality. It is there, of course. If duality is not there, of course, if pot is not there, clay, of course, is there. But clay alone is in spite of parts. So clay alone is in spite of parts, not only in the absence of part. If clay was there only in absence of part, and when part comes and the clay doesn't remain, then it's a different kind of a situation. But here, clay alone is. Whether part is or part is not. Meaning that the presence of the part does not in any way create a sense of separatedness or a sense of limitation in clay. clay abides in its own glory of all non-duality, all pervasiveness, in spite of the part being there. So there is no nanatvam, there is no duality. In the universe, there is no nanatvam, no duality. The Upanishad proclaims that in so many words. Upanishad assert the non-duality and condemn the duality. Two things are there. They praise non-duality and condemn the duality. Mrityosu mrityum gacchati yah naneva pashyati. The one who gives reality to duality. At first sight, looks like the world is different from me. At first sight, the world is different from me. It is different from me. Depends on your definition of me. World is different from me if I confine myself to this body, mind, sense, complex. Yes, it is different. But I as really I am. It's body, mind, sense, complex. I am not. I am just a consciousness which is no form, which is no location. Then all there is one. So it depends on where I am coming from. See, the way I perceive the world is determined by the way I perceive myself. If I perceive myself as confined to this body mind, then whatever is outside the boundary of this body is outside of me. Like this little pot, as long as thinks that the clay thinks that I am confined to this form only, so long this pot is different from clay, different from this pot. But if the pot recognizes that I am not confined to this form, I am clay. Form is not my nature, clay is my nature. When this pot recognizes, then what? It recognizes, hey, I am very much present in this pot also, in that pot also, in all parts also. I am sarvavyapi, I pervade everything, the self of everything. Then duality doesn't remain. So duality is because of ignorance. And when the knowledge takes place, I realize all there is one, that's the self. So that is how the nature, the dvaita mithyatvam, that dvaita, the non-self, is mithya, and therefore it cannot create, cause a sense of division. Yes, in spite of dvaita world being there, there is still non-duality. Then the thought proceeds, okay, then what about this jagat? You say there is not separate, what is it then? So we are now on verse 49, as we were seeing yesterday. Let us read that verse. So now the next section establishes that this world is nothing but Atma. All parts are nothing but clay. All waves are nothing but water. Or this universe of names and forms is nothing but Brahman or Atma. So, depending on how we look at the world, as I said, my perception of the world is determined by my perception of myself. If I look upon myself as an individual conscious being, then the world is different from me. My perception changes. That I am, there is no individuality in consciousness. Individuality is all in this body, mind, sense, complex, individual consciousness. That I am formless, changeless consciousness, then I include everything. As long as I confine myself to this one body, mind, sense, so long I excluded everything. But when my perception of myself changes, just as this part's perception of itself changes and I'm clay. Then how it finds itself? Pervading everything. So also, when my perception of myself changes, I realize that the universe also is the same. I am Brahman, universe also is Brahman. That is how there is no duality. If I am one entity, universe is different entity, of course there is duality. So the author shows, enables us to see, now makes us see how not only you are Brahman, but Jagat or universe also is Brahman. So it says, Brahmana Sarva Bhutani Jayante Paramatmanah Tasmadetani Brahmeva Bhavanti Tyavadharaye. So now, what is this part? Question is, what is this part? Then, to understand nature of part, you perform an inquiry like this. Kasmat jatam, where is this part born of? What sustains this part? What is the abiding aspect of this part? The part has two aspects. One is a changing aspect, other is the abiding or unchanging aspect. What is the changing aspect? Right now this object has a certain form, which we call part, falls away from hand and breaks down. You call it by a different name, you call them shards, you call some other name. And further if you pound it, becomes powder. Further you subdivide it, become molecules, atoms, whatever. But during all the stages, one thing remains constant. It's clay. The clayness is never given up. One thing that this object can never give up is the clayness. As far as the name and form is concerned, it is subject to change. That it is clay is not subject to change. Therefore, in what we call part, there is a changing aspect and there is a changeless aspect. Therefore, what is this part? What is the part? Is the form the part? Or the clay the part? Some people say that, what do you mean part is clay? You can't fill water in clay, can you? Can you carry water in clay? Can you fill water in clay? How can there is only clay? That's an emotional issue, you know. But objective issue is what? Emotional is one thing, objective is another thing. See, Vedanta is not emotional people. No scientist, everybody. Anybody who wants to know the truth is always an objective person. I mean, in the lab, in the pathology laboratory, when you are examining blood sample, it's blood sample. So the technician has no difficulty in, you know, only when it comes to know this blood, my wife's blood, wait a minute. Then something happens there. Then he cannot remain objective anymore. To remain objective, even then the part's usefulness is because of what? It's because of clay. And therefore, what this object is clay. That it is a form, its usefulness is incidental. That it is clay is inherent. So this is how we come to the conclusion that what is part? That from which it is born, by which it is sustained, under which it goes back, which is the abiding aspect of the part. The unchanging aspect of the part is the reality of the part. For Vedantin, you know, what is meant by objectivity? Vedantin defines Satyam as Abhaditam, that which cannot be negated, that which is not subject to change. So anything that is subject to change, anything that can be negated cannot be truth. However, you know, whether it is mine, yours, and So you go to take this ornament to a goldsmith and then, you know, in this, so you have to sell it somehow. It's a painful thing. That what takes it and puts it in a pan, you know. Hey, this is given by my mother. And, you know, as far as goldsmith is concerned, it's just gold, you know. So similarly, what is truth? That which cannot be negated. Formerly it was with your mother, now it's with you, now it'll be with me, and tomorrow it'll be with somebody else. That's changing aspect. That is change, is that, you know, that is the changeless aspect. So what cannot be negated, what does not change is called Satyam. Usefulness is not consistent. That this thing is available for filling water as long as it possesses this form. If form changes, then you can't fill water in this. So usefulness is what? Transitory. Its nature is sustaining. So abhaditam satyam. In anything that is called satyam or truth or real, which cannot be negated, which does not change. In this one, only clay cannot be negated. Therefore, clay satyam. Similarly, we'll see what is this universe. Brahmana sarupani jayante bhutani. All the beings are born of Brahman. Brahmana paramatmana. Brahman, that is paramatma. That is atma. So Brahman alone, so that is necessary to say. So the equation here in this verse 49, Brahmana paramatmana. So Brahmana, which case is this? Which case is Brahmana at the back? What's the case of the word Brahmana? Fifth case. Oh, which word is that? Paramatmana, which case is that? Paramatmana, which case is that? Fifth? Or which word? Paramatman. So both of them, one case is Samanadikaranya. Meaning both the words refer to one entity. So Brahmana, Paramatmana. So Brahman, that is Paramatma. You see, that's what it means. Brahmana, Brahmana, Paramatma. From Brahman, that is Paramatma, Sarabhutani Jayanti, all the beings are born. As Taittiriya Upanishad would say, tasmadva etasmad atmana akasha sambhuta. Tasmad brahmana etasmad atmana. So Brahman, that Brahman which is itself, from there the universe has emerged. So this verse also tells, it's called anuvada. So reiterating what is stated in the Upanishad, no need to say paramatmana. But this is referred to Taittiriya Upanishad. Brahmana, Paramatmana. Brahman is not something else. It is a self, Atmana. It is myself. And Atma is not an individual. Paramatmana. Param means what? Free from the limitation of time, place and objectivity. So Atma is Paramatma. The self is limitless. Free from limitation of time, place and objectivity. That Atma which is Brahman. From that, the universe emerges, by which it is sustained, unto which it goes back. So is Brahman or Paramatma is what we call the material cause or definition. Clay is the material cause because the pot is born of clay, sustained by clay, merges back into clay. So also the Upanishad says the universe is, it emerges from Brahman. Sustained by Brahman, merges back into Brahman, and Brahman, that is Atma. So Brahman, or Atma becomes what? The material cause, the Atma of the universe. So clay is the material cause, also clay is the Atma of this pot, you know. What is the Atma of this pot? Clay is the Atma or the self of this pot. Because clay, a pot cannot be without clay. So similarly, if Brahman or the Atma is the material cause of the universe, it amounts to saying that Brahman or the Atma is the self of the universe. Who is Atma? I am the self of the universe. Ita avadharaye, therefore may you see this. Avadharaye. So the teacher is now telling the disciple, avadharaye, may you come to this understanding. May you come to this conviction. Tasmadetani brahmayo bhavanti. Since all these beings, things and beings are born from Brahman, sustained by Brahman, they emerge back into Brahman. Therefore, Brahman is the material cause. So just as you should know that all the parts are nothing but clay, similarly, may you know that this universe is nothing but Brahman. Helping us to change our perception. Our perception is that this is what it is. Universe is all diversity and all the, you know, variety, diversity, disparity, that's all it is. Says, no, look at closely. Look at everything closely. In everything, there is a changing aspect. There is also the changes aspect. In you and me, in anything. What is changing aspect? The name and form. What is changes aspect? Not clay. Even clay also changes. The clay was just an example. But clay also doesn't remain ever the same. It also changes. What is it that does not change? Asti, Bhati, Priyam. That is, so regardless of what happens to his name and form, whether it is pot, whether it is cloth or shards, whether it is powder, the fact that it is, that isness never goes away. You can never deny isness of something. Even though all changes may take place, that is. Pot is, clay is, molecule is, atom is, electron is, boson part is, that isness never goes. Regardless of what you do, you cannot deny is. So undeniable, non-negative, is the truth of this. How do you know that it is? I know, because it shines. It is the Bhati. So therefore, now when you have to evaluate something, say, avadharayet, don't simply evaluate something by its external appearance. But in your mind, ask, what is it in reality? Don't simply judge this object chain from external appearance and say it is chain. Realize that it is gold. Then bangle also is gold. Earring also is gold. The whole universe of ornaments is born of gold, sustained by gold, merges back into gold, is nothing but gold. And thus, they're asking us how to see. Vimudaha nanu pashyandi pashyandi jnana chakshushah. The deluded fellows only give reality to what they see, they don't see. Even though it is there, but they don't see. Jnana chakshushah. They apply the knowledge also, buddhi also, and understand what the eyes are revealing. Then no doubt eyes are revealing many things, manyness. But in that manyness, in that form, etc., that is revealed, what is the abiding aspect? What's the truth about this? Asti Bhati Avadhare. May you have this conviction that etani brahmaya bhavanti, All of these are nothing but Brahman. No, naam roop karma bhedena visitrani bhutani. So question arises that when we look at this universe, everything is different from everything else. Every entity has a name, has a form, and has a role or a function. Everything has a name, a form, and a function. The table has a name, a form corresponding to the name table, and a function that it sustains all these books and stuff like that. That's the purpose it serves. The universe, anything that is there has these three aspects. A name, a form, and a function. Because nothing is redundant. In the creation of Ishvara, Ishvara being omniscient, intelligent, therefore nothing that is created is redundant. Therefore everything has a function or a role to play. Therefore, every object can be described by these three parameters. Nama, Rupa, Karma. Everything has a name, a corresponding form, and a function. So question is, when everything is so different from everything else, I see no similar, no oneness, no similarity at all. Nama rupa karma bhedena vichitrani bhutani. Vichitrani, there are variegated beings and things are there, each having its own name, form and function. How do you say they are all one? So that question is answered in the next verse. Brahmaiva sarvanamani rupani vividhani cha कर्माण्यपि समग्राणि विवर्ति इति श्रुतिर्जगौ. सो नाउ अर्लियर वाज तैतरीय उपनिषद, नाउ कम्स बृहदारण्यक उपनिषद. त्रयं वा इदं नाम रूपं कर्म इति. So, the Upanishad says, it's not quoted here, otherwise this translator quotes almost all statements of Shruti. But Trayam Vaidam, this universe is what? Consisting of these three things, Nama, Rupam, Karma. The name, form and function. So, Upanishad reduces the whole thing to three. We may have many varieties. This is good and bad and this saint and sinner and all kinds of differences we have. Brahmana, Kshatriya, this, that, all kinds of differences we have. White and black and man and woman, this, that, that. First of all, it reduces to only three common aspects. Everything and anything can be described as having a name, a form, and a function. Doesn't matter man or woman, young or old, sentient or insentient, precious or useless, whatever it is, these three will always be there. Nama, Rupa, Karma. See, what a nice way of classifying. See, the way to understand something is to classify. Otherwise, it's such diversity. If you want to understand each individual thing, it's impossible. Therefore, we find that nothing, anything can be described as name, form and function. That's all the universe is. So, Brahmaiva sura namani rupani vivitani cha karmani api samagrani. The verse says, Brahmaiva, all the names are Brahman. Vividani Rupani, all the variety of forms also are Brahman. Karmani Api, and all the karma functions also are Brahman. How do you say that? Because bivarti shruti jagau, shruti hi jagau. Brahmaiva samagrani bivarti. Because Brahman sustains all the names, sustains all the forms, sustains all the actions. Therefore, name, form and action is not apart from Brahman. For example, the clay alone sustains a pot. Clay alone sustains a pitcher. Clay alone sustains any other kind of a thing. Therefore, they are not apart from clay. Similarly, it is Brahman that sustains all names, all forms and all functions. Meaning a name, just as a part, cannot be without the clay which sustains it. So also, names, forms or functions cannot be without Brahman. Brahman sustains them all. How? Why is Brahman sustaining names and forms and functions? As asti, bhati, priyam. Whatever name is, name is. Name shines. Name is dear. Form is. Form shines. Form is dear. Function is. Function is known. Shines means is known. Useful, dear. So number one, that name and form and function can never be apart from isness. For anything to be, isness must be there. Pot is. Isness has to be there. How do you say it is? Because it is known, it shines. Swasti and bhati and priyam, they all go together. So, this object, you don't call it pot. What do you call it? Name, form and function. This thing is what? Name, form and function. So, rather than giving individuals name, form and function, they are sustained by asti bhati, by Brahman. Therefore, the whole universe is sustained by Brahman. Therefore, the whole universe, in spite of the diversity, names are countless, forms are countless, functions are countless. In spite of all diversity and disparity, something is good, something is bad, something is great, something is... All diversities, all of them are all sustained by asti, bhati, priyam, Brahman. Therefore, in spite of the division and diversity, apparently, what is Brahman. So, same example is given in next verse. Simple example that we can understand. Suvarna jaya manasya. Suvarna tvam cha shashvatam. Brahmano jaya manasya. Brahmatvam cha tatha bhavet. Suvarna jayamanasya, whatever is born of gold, suvarnatvam cha shashvatam. So, see these words. Suvarna jayamanasya, that which is born of gold, of that, suvarnatvam cha shashvatam, the goldness is shashvatam, is imperishable. Whatever is born of gold, that thing's goldness is eternal, imperishable. So this bangle is born of gold. In this bangle, the gold is what? Shashvatam. Bangle also is a name and a form and a function. There is not Shashvatam. There is what? There is only incidental, changing. But what is born of gold? The goldness is what? Is very essence. Changeless. Similarly, what is born Brahman? Brahmanness is essential. Brahmano jayamanasya, brahmatvam cha tathavai. Similarly, what is all born of Brahman? ది బ్రహ్మత్వం అస్థిభాది ప్రియత్వం ఇస్ శాశ్వతం ఇస్ ఇటర్నల్ అండ్ నేమ్స్ ఫార్మ్స్ అండ్ ఫంక్షన్స్ కమ్ అండ్ గో. In spite of this, all right, you say that there is non-duality. Suppose, you know, I don't accept it. What is the contribution of this non-duality in my life? Tell me. Why do you insist upon this? Why do you insist upon establishing that there is only non-dual, one without a second? That's the basis of everything. Why do you insist upon that? And that non-dual is not out there, not is mine and myself, meaning I am alone everything, understand? Even though the word Brahman is used, but if Brahman is non-dual, then Brahman has to be myself, otherwise it will be dual. So in essence, what the Upanishad is saying is that self alone is. So even though we say everything is Ishvara, what is Ishvara? Better than that is what? What is self. That's when the loop is complete. Ishvara still remains an entity other than me. When we use the word God or Ishvara, still we think is, there was the ultimate thing will be what? What is? But that's a little difficult to swallow. So begin with this. What is the self. What is I. Then only there can be non-duality. If what is Ishvara and I am I, then also there can be some problem. What is a self. So, why such an insistence on non-duality? If someone does not respect the non-duality, someone continues to take duality, what will happen? I'm living my life every day. I never knew non-duality. It never came in my life. It never mattered to me. I still went to work. I had my income. I had my house and family and everything else is there. What does non-duality do with my life? Tell me. Why should we bother about things if there's nothing to do with my life, isn't it? Is it all? That is a black hole. Let it maybe. You know, it doesn't matter to me whether it's there or not. Millions of things are there in the universe which may be fascinating, but that's okay. I mean, doesn't matter to me. Is this non-duality one of those things which is like a black hole which I'm unconcerned? Says, no, it is very important to you. Why? So next verse says, yeah. Svalpamapyantaram krutva jivatma paramatmano. Yasantishtati mudatma bhayam tasya vibhashitam. Svalpam abhyantaram krutva. You create even a slight difference in slight duality. With what? Jivatma paramatmanoho. I am Jivatma and there is Paramatma or Brahman. So Jivatma, individual self. Paramatma, the limitless self. Or Brahman. So what does it matter whether Brahman, I am myself or what does it matter? How does it affect my life? He says, when you create even a slight duality distance between yourself and Brahman. He says, you create that. I didn't create, you create. Because Paramatma happens to be Jivatma. Jivatma happens to be Paramatma. Jivatma means individual self. Happens to be universal self. Happens to be limitless. Happens to be Brahman. Happens to be the substrate of the universe. It is like this pot creating distance with clay. Imagine what will happen. Pot says, what does it matter? Why insists that I am the self of all? That means pot is creating a distance with clay. It's creating. It's not there. pot does not have any distance with the clay. But for the pot to insist that I am different, independent of clay, that means pot is creating a distance with the clay. Only in the mind, but that is enough. See, what is does not matter. What I think is what matters. What is the rope? I think it is snake. That's what matters to me, not what is, unfortunately. If what is mattered, then all of this would have been wonderful. Because what is this Brahman? What is this limitless? No, no. What I think that I am limited, that's what matters. So Upanishad says, Yada hyevaisha etasmin udaramantaram kurde atatasya bhayam bhavati. Drawing from the Taittiriya Upanishad. Yada eva, this person, this ignorant person, etasmin in Brahman in truth, udaramantaram kurde, creates a slight split between myself and Brahman, or myself and Paramatma. You know what it means? I am creating distance with myself. When this part thinks that I don't care, I am different from clay, then you know what it is doing? It is creating a split within its own self. When you create split, then what happens? You feel isolated, because what gives you security is clay. And the part proclaims its independence of clay, then it has no basis at all. It has no support. It becomes what? Supportless, isolated. Moment that distance is created, immediately there is a sense of isolation. Where there is isolation, there is fear. So Upanishad says, Yada hye vaishe tasmin udaramantaram kurushe. This ignorant person creates even a slight difference, slight duality. Atatasya bhayam bhavati. Immediately fear comes to him. So it is nice that we are living our life, Swamiji. Vedanta has nothing to contribute as to your professional career and this and that. But Vedanta is to contribute to your happiness. So you are living life all right. Are you living a happy life? Please tell me. Yes, Swamiji. Look at it closely. No, Swamiji, there are conflicts, no doubt, in my mind also. There are anxieties and worries. All these stresses are there. Anxiety is there. Worries are there. Misunderstanding is there, quarrel is there, fighting is there, that is there. That is where Vedanta comes. But other things you are able to do anyway, that Vedanta doesn't, it's not required to become a doctor or a lawyer or engineer and do that, the world will teach you. How to become happy, how to stay away from, because we are creating unhappiness, therefore. There is no such thing as unhappiness or sorrow. We are creating sorrow for ourselves. So Vedanta teaches, what makes me create sorrow for myself? And therefore, how to stop creating sorrow? That's all. We stop creating sorrow, there is no sorrow. If someone created sorrow for me, then I can't help it, you understand? If sorrow was created by somebody or something other than me, then well, I have to live with it. Upanishad says, I am creating sorrow for myself. And what's the reason? Reason is simple. By creating a split between myself and Paramatma, myself and myself. Then who becomes the cause? Then I'm what becomes the cause of my fear? I become the cause of my fear. You know, standard example of rope snake. See, when I look at, my perception of the object is snake, then I'm afraid. What causes fear? Tell me. The perception of snake causes fear in me. What causes fear in me? The rope causes fear in me. Understand this. What is this rope? But by creating distance with the rope and calling it snake, there is no real snake to cause the fear. Ultimately, it is a rope that causes fear on account of wrongly understanding the rope. Similarly, it is self or I alone causes fear on account of wrongly understanding the self as different from Brahman, as different from the limitless. Udaramantaram kurate atatasya bhayam bhavati. So Upanishad explains as to how all the fear arises from duality. Dvitiyadvai bhayam bhavati. Whether it is dvitiya or duality, mutual exclusion, then the fear arises. So says, svalpamapi antaram krutva. Jivatma paramatmanoho svalpamapi antaram krutva. Jivatma paramatmanoho madhye, between the two, jivatma and paramatma, you create a slight distance between yourself and Ishvara. When I worship Lord Krishna, then also looking upon Lord Krishna is different from myself. Also causes always uneasiness. As long as Bhagavan also is different from me, so long uneasiness is always there. And kurtva, kalpayitva, it is not that Bhagavan is different from me, but I create that difference by calling myself an individual being and then I create the distance. So this distance or duality is effectively created by me by perceiving myself as confined to this body, mind, sense complex. So krutva kalpayitva, so one who lives his life creating a sense of duality or division or separateness or exclusion, then whatever I exclude becomes the source of fear for me. Brihadaranyaka says that if you exclude the world will exclude you. Yassan tishtati mudatma bhayam tasyavivashitam. Therefore, this perception of non-duality is extremely important. Then only we can really become free from fear. And fear stands for all mental afflictions. Fear is a representative. Stands for all mental afflictions, all sadness or sorrow. This duality is the only cause of all unhappiness in our life. We have created. A person also can cause me unhappiness, provided person is different from me, isn't it? If I look upon X as different from me and myself different from X, then X can cause me whatever. Then I will keep on judging whether this fellow likes me or not, I like him or not, and whether what he does is right or not. No. This question doesn't arise in I. In non-I, the question arises. So that is the reason why Vedanta is so important. In order to become free from sorrow, this knowledge only means, because all sorrow is created from ignorance. If sorrow or unhappiness had any reason other than ignorance, then knowledge alone would not be enough. Ignorance also is there, and this, you know, my friend also is there, enemy is also there, XY also is there. If, then merely knowledge will not remove the sorrow. But Vedanta says, all sorrow is created merely from ignorance. As long as ignorance remains of the self, so long it will not be regardless of what you do. Only self-knowledge will remove the cause of all sorrow. So Vedanta teaches how to become free from sorrow. And when sorrow goes, the ananda manifests. So that is the reason why this knowledge becomes so important. In fact, it becomes indispensable. One cannot live a comfortable life without this knowledge. Okay, we'll continue. Oh. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadvyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namah Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Guru.